Hey guys, this is Dr. Sangeeta and welcome back to another lecture of Dental Pachala where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And we have a special guest today because we have surgery video coming up which you all have been waiting for. So meet Mr. Venkat. So today's video we are going to talk about the mid-facial fractures. As you know, mid-face is very important for the smell, vision, as well as for the resonance of the voice. Now if you talk about the voice, so the air sinuses, we have maxillary air sinuses, so all these air sinuses, because of these air sinuses we have resonance in the voice. And the bones in the mid-facial fracture actually takes up all the mastication load, and if we talk about the mastication load, it is too much. You cannot even imagine. So somewhere around 70 to 150 pounds, that will be somewhere equal to 70 kgs. So that much of load our mid face is taking for mastication, and we have something in the mid face which actually takes up all the loads of the muscles. Now we have the pillars, we have the bone arranged in such a pattern that they are taking all the loads of mastication. So while we are chewing, so all the load is taking up while we are chewing. Now you can see the mandible is actually elephant mandible, which we'll talk about in the fracture itself. So these bones of the mid face are aligned in such a way that they are taking all of the load of mastication. Now there are pillars which are taking up all the mid facial load, all the mastication load. So these pillars are known as buttresses, which we will talk about in the today's video also, and in the fracture, because these buttresses are taking up all the load. So it is very important that when we are doing the fracture management, then we are placing the fixation, or we are placing the screws or the plates in the specific region in the buttresses. And as you can see, mandible is a long bone, but if we look at the facial bone, now we have so many small bones which are attached to each other, and that forms the mid facial complex. So these bones in the mid facial, they articulate with each other. So as you can see, this is the zygomatic bone, which is aligned with the maxillary bone. So like that, one bone is articulated with each other, and therefore they make a complex. So they cannot, there is not a fracture of individual bones. So there will be a fracture of combination. So there is not independent fracture of mid facial. There will be a complex of the other fracture also. And the bones of mid face are very thin. As you can see, these bones are very thin. So these thin cortical bones, as well as there are trabeculae pattern which is present in the maxilla, if we compare it with the mandible. Now mandible is a strong bone, but if we look at the mid facial, there are weak bones, there are cortical. These thin cortical bones are made up of cancellous bone, so there is a porous structure, so they are very easily prone to fracture also. And because these bones are very fragile, so any force which is coming towards the skull, these bones are bearing. So any force, suppose if any injury is coming from down, so all of these mid face is actually taking all of the stress. They are not letting the skull damage, or they are not letting the brain damage. So somehow they are protecting the brain, somehow they are protecting the skull and taking all the forces, taking all the traumatic forces on themselves, and they are crushing, and there is a fracture of mid face while protecting for the skull or the brain. Also, these bones are protecting the vital structures such as eyes, brain, and the spinal cord. So basically the mid face is doing all of the protection work. So normally the mid facial fracture is due to the sports injury, or either a car traffic accident, any road traffic accident, assaults, or any fall injury. So mid facial fracture is not an individual fracture. It follows a set pattern of fracture. So today's video we are going to talk about the mid facial fracture. So without further ado, let's jump into it. And before we get started, make sure you subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon. That way you get a notification as soon as I release a video lecture. So we have a special guest, Mr. Venkat, who will be helping us to explain the anatomy of the mid face. Now if you want to study the fracture of the mid face, it is very important that you understand the anatomy of the face first. Number of bones in the skull are 22, and out of that the splanchnocranium is the bones of the face, which are out of that 14 bones.
So we will be talking about the midface anatomy. So in midface anatomy, we have the maxilla. So this part is the maxilla. If you can see, this is the maxilla. This is the zygomatic bone. This is the orbit in which there are eyeballs, eye part. This is the frontal process of the skull. And we have the palatine bone. And this is again the zygomatic arch. You can see the zygomatic arch. This is the body of the zygomatic. Now one by one we'll talk about. So the maxilla, this is the maxilla, right? The maxilla has three processes. The first one is the, which is going towards the frontal bone. So which is going towards the frontal bone is the frontal process of the maxilla. Then which is going towards the zygomatic arch. Because this is in an arch form. See, if you can see, this is in an arch form. So because this is in an arch form like that arch, this is why that is, that's the reason this is also known as the zygomatic arch. So if you can see, the maxillary part which is towards the zygomatic arch is the zygomatic process of the maxilla. Also third process is the alveolar process of the maxilla, which contains the teeth, which has the alveolar component, which contains the alveolar bone. So we have three components of the maxilla: the frontal process of the maxilla, the zygomatic process of the maxilla, and the alveolar process of the maxilla. Coming to the zygomatic bone, now you can see the zygomatic bone. This is the cheek bone. This is the malar processes. And so this zygomatic arch or zygomatic bone, this is the body of the zygomatic bone. It has four processes. Now the maxilla has had three. Now it has four. The first one which is going towards the maxilla is the maxillary process. The one which is going towards the frontal bone is the frontal process. The one which is going towards the temporal bone, so this is the temporal bone, right? One which is going towards the temporal bone is the temporal process of the zygomatic arch. And the fourth one is which is going towards the orbital bone is the orbital process of the zygomatic arch. So we have four processes. The one which is going towards the frontal bone is the frontal process. Going towards the orbital bone is the orbital process. Towards the maxillary bone is the maxillary process. Going toward the temporal bone is the temporal process of the zygomatic arch. So talking about the palatine bone, this is the palatine bone which forms the hard palate. So there are two plates of the palatine bone. The first one is the horizontal plate. Always the structure which lies horizontally is always the horizontal plate. The one which lies perpendicular is the perpendicular plate. Now if you can see, this is the perpendicular plate, which is perpendicular. If you separate this, you can see the perpendicular plate. The next one we have here, in here we have is the vomer bone. So if you want to see the vomer bone, actually the vomer bone is, this is the nose, nasal aperture, right? This is the piriform aperture. So this is the nasal aperture or the piriform aperture. And we have nasal septum in here. And in here we have the nasal cartilage, which is not present in the skull, of course, because there is a soft tissue landmark. So if we see, if we look at, so if we go deep inside and up till the extent, if you go, this part, last part of the posterior most part of the nasal septum is our vomer bone. So if you see from this view, you can see this is the vomer bone. This also I have fractured many of the thin bones, because I, for demonstration purpose, I made a cast in my PGs. I had a seminar for that. I made a cast of the plaster of Paris and I blocked all of these foramens, and still I cannot remove the wax. So this is my whole story behind all of these waxes in the foramens, because I blocked it, and that was the time that I fractured the ethmoidal bone also. So coming back again to the topic, this is our vomer bone. Now you can see the vomer bone. Actually, this is the post. If you see the posterior most part, you can see the vomer bone. So now here, this is the orbit, right? In the orbit is the, we have the lacrimal bone. Now this is the nose, this is the nasal bone, and this is the frontonasal suture, and here is the lacrimal bone. And after lacrimal bone, the bone which is missing, actually here is supposed to be the ethmoid bone. So the part of the bone which is missing is the ethmoid bone, is fractured in this case. Then we have the sphenoid bone. Now if you want to understand the sphenoid bone, actually you want a cut section or the cross section. The sphenoid bone, we have the four processes. The main part is that this is the body of the sphenoid bone. This is the cut section. And once we see the cut section, so this is the body of the sphenoid. We have the lesser wing of the sphenoid. This part, this part is the lesser wing of the sphenoid. Now this part is the lesser wing of the sphenoid, and this one is the greater wing of the sphenoid. And you want to see, if you want to see the from the front view, now this is the lesser wing of the sphenoid, this one is the greater wing of the sphenoid. So the lesser wing of the sphenoid is close to the optic canal. So as you can see, this part is the greater wing of the sphenoid, and the one which is close to the optic canal, this is the optic canal. The one which is close to the optic canal is the lesser wing of the sphenoid. This is the supraorbital fissure, and this is the infraorbital fissure. And or infraorbital fissure we can also see from this view also. So this is the infraorbital fissure again. So these are the pterygoid plates, because we are covering pterygoid. We can see from here. So the one which is towards the midline, this is the midline, right? So one which is towards the midline is always the medial. One which is away from the midline is the lateral pterygoid plate. So this is the lateral pterygoid plate, and this is the medial pterygoid plate. This is the lateral pterygoid plate. Lateral pterygoid, medial pterygoid, and we have the womer. Now talking again, this ethmoid bone is actually missing. So we have after lacrimal bone here. So after the lacrimal bone, here is the after nasal bone is the lacrimal bone in the orbit, and after that we have the ethmoid bone which is missing. So the basically the sphenoid bone has four processes: the body, the lesser wing, the greater wing, and the pterygoid processes, the medial pterygoid, the lateral pterygoid. So this is about the sphenoid bone. So the body is actually close to the nasal cavity, and the medial wall of the optic canal. Lesser wing is close to the optic canal. The greater wing is from the infratemporal surfaces. If you see the greater wing of the sphenoid, it has foramen rotundum in here. So foramen rotundum, from which the maxillary division of the trigeminal nerve passes, which we have already covered in the trigeminal nerve. You can find it in the playlist if you haven't watched the video. Then we have the foramen ovale, from which the mandibular nerve pass. Also we have foramen spinosum in the posterior part of the greater wing of the sphenoid. So this is the foramen spinosum. So superior orbital fissure, pterygoid, all that we have covered. We have covered the ethmoidal bone. So we haven't covered the nasal. So the nasal septum, here we have the inferior concha. As you can see from the front, if you can see, these are the conchas. Oh shit, I broke. So these are the inferior concha which I broke right now, and then we have the middle and the superior concha also. So like that only the whole skull is breaking. I'm breaking like that. I'm studying and breaking, and rest of the skull I broke while taking an impression from alginate I took. So while duplicating the skull, and I donated it to one of my junior. So talking about, this is the anatomy of the midface. We have covered the anatomy of the midface. Now that you are familiar with the anatomy of the midface, now that you know, this is the zygomatic bone, which is the sphenoid bone. Now you know, this is the sphenoid bone. This is the ethmoid bone. This is the womer bone. Now you will be able to understand the fractures, midfacial fractures, because we are going to cover the fracture lines accordingly. Fracture is the discontinuity in the bone. So we'll be talking about the midfacial fracture. So today's video also we will cover the midfacial fractures, classification of the midfacial fracture. Any discontinuity in the bone is the fracture. So we are talking about the classification. So René Lefort in 1901 gave the classification, and he studied the cadaver, and at some distance, at the some speed, he fractured the skulls of the cadaver, and he studied all of the fractures. So there are three fractures: the Lefort 1 fracture, Lefort 2 fracture, and Lefort 3 fracture, according to René Lefort. And these are the first two are the subzygomatic fractures. So these fractures are below the zygomatic arch. So these 1 and 2 fracture are below this zygomatic arch, and the third fracture is above the zygomatic arch. So Lefort 1 and Lefort 2 are the subzygomatic fracture. Lefort 3 is the suprazygomatic fracture, which is above the zygomatic arch. And according to Rowe and William, so Rowe and William classified, and William in 1985, he classified Rowe and William, he gave two kind of fracture. The one which is not involving the occlusion, one which is not involving the teeth. So one which is the fracture not involving the occlusion, and the fracture involving the occlusion. Not involving the occlusion, also there are two kinds: the one in the central line and one in the lateral line. So one in the central line will be all of the fractures which are occurring in the center of the face. That is the, if you see, that is the fracture of the nasal bone, fracture of the nasal septum, nasal lateral nasal injury, anterior nasal injury, the frontal process of the maxillary fracture. So any ethmoidal bone fracture, the nasoorbital ethmoidal fracture is our central fracture. So the fracture occurring in the central line. And next one he talked about, in the fracture not only occlusion, we have the lateral fractures. So in the lateral region we have the zygomatic bone fractures. See, we'll be talking about all the lateral regions. So any fracture in the zygomatic arch, any fracture in the maxillary arch, except the dentoalveolar fracture, because dentoalveolar fracture is covered in the occlusion, fracture involving the occlusion. So fracture involving the occlusion, there is dentoalveolar fracture. So there is any fracture of the alveolar bone and the tooth. Also there is subzygomatic fracture. In that we will cover the Lefort 1 and Lefort 2, and the third one is the suprazygomatic. That also will cover, that will also will include the occlusion, that is the Lefort 3. And according to the Erich, so the third classification is according to the Erich in 1942, we gave based on the direction of the fracture line. So either it is a horizontal fracture or it is a pyramidal fracture, because we will cover the Lefort 2, Lefort 3 will cover. So the if it is like this, if the fracture is like this, so it is going to be a pyramidal like this, right? So if this it is separating like this, so it is a pyramidal fracture. So either it is a horizontal fracture, pyramidal fracture, or the transverse fracture. Then also there is a, depending on, there is a classification depending on the level of the fracture line. So either it is a low level fracture line, it is mid level fracture line, or it is high level fracture line. So based on that also we have the low level, mid level, and the high level fracture. So the, also there is a classification depending on the fracture line of the zygomatic bone. So either it is below the zygomatic or it is above the zygomatic. So below the zygomatic is the subzygomatic fracture, above the zygomatic bone is the suprazygomatic fracture. And subzygomatic fracture we have Lefort 1 and Lefort 2. Suprazygomatic we have Lefort 3 fracture. So Lefort 1 and Lefort 2 are the subzygomatic fracture, Lefort 1 here, Lefort 2 here, and we have suprazygomatic Lefort 3 fracture. So to brush it up, Renelle Lefort in 1901, he studied on the cadaver, dissected it, and he studied three level of fractures, the Lefort 1, Lefort 2, Lefort 3. Lefort 1 and Lefort 2 are above the zygomatic arch, so this is the zygomatic arch, above the zygomatic arch are Lefort 3, and below the zygomatic arch is Lefort 1 and 2. So subzygomatic is which is below the zygomatic arch. So we have the Lefort 1 fracture as well as the Lefort 2 fracture, which is below the zygomatic arch, subzygomatic. And the third, which is the suprazygomatic, so suprazygomatic is the Lefort 3 fracture. So this is the Lefort 3 fracture, suprazygomatic. Then Rowe and William classified fracture based on the occlusion, involving the occlusion, not involving the occlusion, involving the occlusion, the fracture which are occurring in the central region. So occurring in the central region, we have the nasal bone fracture, and we also have the nasal septal fracture. We also have the orbital frontal process of maxillary fracture, the ethmoidal bone fracture, which I already fractured. So we have the nasoorbital ethmoidal fracture, the NOE fracture. The lateral region, which is in the lateral region. So the another one is a lateral region fracture, which will be the zygomatic or complex fracture. So any fracture of the zygomatic bone which is associated with the any fracture of the maxillary complex. So that is the zygomatic bone fracture, the maxillary arch fracture, and the next one is the fracture involving the occlusion. So fracture involving the occlusion will be the fracture of the teeth associated with the fracture of the alveolar process or alveolar bone, so dentoalveolar fracture. And the subzygomatic, which is Lefort 1 and Lefort 2, and the suprazygomatic is Lefort 3 fracture. Also according to Erich in 1942, on the direction of the fracture line, the horizontal pyramidal transverse, and also depending on the fracture level of the fracture line, it can be a low level fracture, the mid level fracture, or the high level fracture. So this is the classification of the mid facial fractures. And now that you know the anatomy, now that you know the classification, and we can proceed with the Lefort fractures. From the next video, we'll have the Lefort 1 fracture, then we have the Lefort 2 and the Lefort 3 fracture. So if you enjoy the video, like it, share it, subscribe it. And if you enjoy watching our video, then share it with your friends. And stay home, stay safe, keep watching.